Well, I'm going to go for it. Whether you can hear, hopefully you can hear me. So welcome everybody to our second plenary. Okay, happy on sound. Yeah, great, good. Welcome. You will need your app today. So those of us who have just joined us, make sure you've got the app. Details are up there. And go to polling. There will be a quick bit of polling in this really interesting session. So, right, let's crack on. I'm really delighted to introduce the chair of this session, is Graham Long. Graham is a senior lecturer in politics at Newcastle University. He has been researching the Sustainable Development Goals since 2013, focusing on their conceptual normative framework. From 2014-15, he worked to support NGO and academic involvement in negotiations to agree the goals, so in the UN and the EU context. So Graham, thank you for that. One of his current research projects explores the implications of the SDGs in the UK, mapping current UK data onto SDG targets to generate a picture of the relevance and applicability to the UK. So please join me in welcoming Graham Long.
Thank you. So we start with a quick bit of polling. Thanks for coming. To start things off, I'm very interested to hear how people would align themselves with the different streams of the conference. We thought that might be quite a good way to kind of get a sense of the room. So before I do any talking, there's a little bit of work for you to do, which is just to use the live polling app. You can kind of connect to the app if you're not already. And then we've only got two polling questions. There's not tons of it in the session. There's one at the start, one at the end. So the question we're interested in your responses to. So the EAUC conference is themed around six streams. You've seen this is the way this is organised. Which of these streams do you feel is most relevant for higher and further education institutions? So I know it's one of these questions which is kind of deceptively simple and the answers are very complicated. Just give it your best shot, please. I'd be interested to hear back. Okay, so that's it's interesting to see where people think the relevance for higher and further education is. And that's especially interesting because some of the things I think we're going to say over the next hour challenges some of that. So I can see Maria go, So I think that's very interesting background. And we'll try and put that today, not exactly to the test, but we'll try and put it in some context, both in the UK, but also in terms of what institutions might do in terms of their contribution through their estates as an employer in the local community, these sorts of things. Hopefully, so I guess we're asking about which of these is biggest, and that doesn't really tell us how important you think the rest of them are relative to the one you've chosen. But hopefully there's reason to think that there's important work in other areas too. Thanks. So I'm just going to give you some very brief context on the SDGs in the UK. Because it might be thought that the kind of the context for the UK generally is quite a narrow one. People tend to think that the agenda in the UK is primarily environmental. And I've got some work which shows that's not wholly true. So across the 17 SDGs, there are probably 170 or so indicators which we can measure the UK against. It makes sense to measure the UK against. But there's actually a large range of targets, so the 2025 top-tier targets, maybe 60-65 beyond that. But it seems pretty clearly, when you take the target and the current state of affairs in the UK, where there's work for the UK to do, potentially. So there definitely is work to be done on affordable and clean energy. There definitely is work to be done on sustainable consumption and production. But there's also work to be done on poverty. There's a very clear target in the SDGs on poverty by national definitions. And it's pretty clearly an agenda for the UK there. We have plenty of people living in poverty in the UK. We have plenty of undernourished people in the UK, which doesn't get a lot of press, especially amongst the elderly and vulnerable. So goal two maybe is more relevant than you might think it is. Gender equality is clearly relevant for the UK. I think that the stat there kind of speaks for itself about that. But there's a lot more to gender equality than just ending violence against women and girls. But there's clearly relevance in goal five as well. There's clear relevance, maybe this is where we get to what we're going to talk about today, under goal 11 on sustainable cities and communities. Whereas I've heard in other sessions, universities are communities, but they're also part of wider communities. There's quite a wide action agenda in the UK, and that skims the surface. I don't have time to give you, you'll be pleased to hear all 120 pages of data by goal and target. Just to give, so I'm not trying to tell anyone what the university should do about the SDGs, but I am going to say that whatever you do about the SDGs, you should be mindful of the kind of agenda the SDGs are. So the SDGs are a universal agenda. So we should think about the contribution to the UK context, but you should also think about the contribution to the global context, the global realisation of the goals. And there's clearly kind of a global agenda for universities here about how they cooperate elsewhere in the world, how they help with technology transfer, collaborative research, scholarships for students. There's also a local agenda about what they do in their own city or region. The SDGs are an interconnected agenda. So I think you've maybe seen this in some of the sessions over the last day or so, but here in the plenary, it's worth saying again that these are interconnected. And so in kind of academic research terms, they're going to be interdisciplinary. They demand from a university policy coherence, which is something I maybe haven't heard much about over the last couple of days, across aspects of the university's work which aren't natural collaborators, maybe. So including areas of teaching, research, the estate, the university as an employer. A set of coherent policies need to be in place to address the SDGs. I'm not going to tell you what those policies should be, but I'm just advising that policy coherence is important. Lastly, if there's a kind of big ethical commitment to the SDGs, it's that they are, at their core, an equality agenda. The commitment at the start of the SDGs and the review framework for the SDGs realised in some of the goals, but also surrounding the goals, is the idea that the SDGs should leave no one behind. This is how the governments, when they signed this, the pledge they made at the start. And leaving no one behind means looking out for the vulnerable, disadvantaged, the marginalised, and intersections of different categories of disadvantage. And that's something that can guide policy and how you review your policy for all actors, whether they be kind of international actors, corporations, governments, local authorities, but also universities. So that's all I want to say. So we look especially, I guess, in what follows, at the university's contribution to the SDGs within the confines of the university, and I guess in terms of its contribution to SDG 11, to cities and local communities. And that's really where this session's focused, but that's the larger picture. Okay, so with that, I'll pass over to our first speaker. So, Maria Adebowale-Schwarte is founding director of the Living Space Project. Living Space Project is an urban placemaking think tank, social enterprise, and consultancy. And she's going to talk about some of these themes in the context of her work.
I do, yeah. That would help, wouldn't it? You wouldn't believe I've actually been working on smart cities and placemaking, and I can't even switch on my microphone. Right, so before I start telling you a little bit about me and why placemaking is absolutely crucial for all of you and this university and others and the cities in which you work and have impact on, I'm going to ask you to close your eyes. Yes, one of those embarrassing exercises, but I'm going to ask you to close your eyes just for a moment. You know, let go of the coffee, breathe, forget the caffeine. And I just want you to think just about a place that you have really liked. You might have gone past it on the train. You might have lived there. You might be really jealous because actually it's where your friends live. But that place has got to be both about buildings and about spaces. And I want you to kind of imagine slowly walking around that space. What does it smell like? What does it look like? What's the design? Who are the kind of people that you want to sit next to who are there? Why would you go back again? How does it make you feel? Safe? Chilled? Happy? Feeling like a shopping spree? Possibly learning a little bit more about where you are, the city, its history. Think more about the feeling as much as the visuals. Okay, and when I snap my fingers, just joking, you can open your eyes. Okay, you know, you hopefully would have been able to imagine something other than lunch. So the reason why I wanted you to think about that is because we all think that we are not placemakers. We all think sometimes that we're not quite sure what this place agenda is actually about. The thing is, you do. You all come from towns, cities, villages, urban or rural, and you know what you like, and you know what you see, and you know in your gut, your very instincts, what makes for a good city, what makes for a good university campus, and actually what makes for a better world, which is increasingly urbanized, and where most campuses are in urban conurbations. So that's kind of what I do. No, I don't make people close their eyes and think about where they used to live or where they'd like to live. But what I do is work on placemaking with a number of organizations, whether it's governments, whether it's universities, or whether it's developers. And it's looking at what is your placemaking strategy? Why should you even be thinking about placemaking? And even more so, why should you be thinking about the Sustainable Development Goals? Okay, well, let me try and explain some of that. The same Sustainable Development Goals, as Graham said, are kind of like a guideline. They're goals for how we want the world to be. And there are very many of them which connect to placemaking. In fact, they all do. And Julie will talk to you a little bit about that as well. You know, they cover economics, they cover equality, they cover income, and they cover inclusivity. And placemaking, if you do that right, if you create a great campus, does exactly the same thing. Initially, place was thought of as something which was sensory, and it is. You hopefully felt some of that in the exercise. It is about the setting. Where is the campus? Where is the building? Where is the park? It's also about the activity. Can people actually use the space that you are managing for the thing that it's meant to be? What's the emotion? What's the connection to that space? Will people stay? You know, will they actually apply to come to Lancaster University and by UCAS form, like I did? I am actually an ex-graduate of Lancaster University, and it's really interesting to be here because I walked up, and actually, when the first day, I was just telling Julie and Sophia in the taxi up, that one of the things that my mum said to me when I got here, we opened up the car door, and she said, "Maria, why did you choose this place?" That's because she thought I was a party girl, which I actually wasn't, but anyway. And the reason why is because we stepped out and it was incredibly green. It was green, it was old farmland, and there were sheep. I kid you not. And actually, it was a beautiful space. And I haven't had a look around now, I'm sure, I'm hoping it still is. But I think people choose where they want to be because of the places and the spaces they're going to be in. It defines who we are as an individual. It defines who you all are as academics or estate managers and what you build and what you teach and how you connect collaboratively to create better spaces. But it also makes for better societies, as do the Sustainable Development Goals. Now, it's not surprising that in 2015, the UN Habitat actually defined that year as the year for placemaking, and ever since have really looked at how they promote placemaking as part of a global goal to create better places and inclusivity. The goal that I tend to focus on, though actually it's not the only one, is SDG 11, which Graham mentioned. And I quote one line from it. It's to make cities inclusive, safe, resilient, and sustainable. Now, you're thinking, well, I'm not designing a city, I'm not talking about cities, that's fine. Just replace city with campus, with building, with parks, whatever you want. Whatever you're doing, you require all those things. It needs to be inclusive, safe, resilient, and sustainable. But of course, all those other goals are also important, as I mentioned. I think what's really crucial, people forget, placemakers like ourselves, we often forget that actually we're also about the economics, not just the design, not just the building. We have a massive economic footprint on the local community or city that we are connected to, if we get it right. So I think a significant factor of placemaking for all of us is not just the institution, it's not just the campus and the university, but it's thinking wider than that. It's also about the neighbouring estate, it's also about Lancaster Town, it's also about the people, and it's most definitely about the local business and international business to which it's connected. Now, I just, for my sins, written a book called The Placemaking Factor, and I thought, oh, I know all about placemaking, I'll write it down, I can do this. And I kept thinking, how do you define it? And people are constantly asking me that. So this is one way I think you can define placemaking if people ask you what the hell you did this morning. Okay, it's a little bit complicated, but it's easy enough. So placemaking is a multifaceted approach. It's what you do. It's a process around creating better spaces, and they're both green and grey. It's also about ownership. How do people own it? And I don't just mean who signed the deeds. I don't just mean who legally owns it, but the relational connection to a place, to a campus, to a town. And also about planning and design and the management of it. So an essential part for a university is about understanding just where it is and the process of place, not just for the buildings itself, but also for the towns and cities to which they're connected. I think one of the most important things about placemaking in universities is the role that you have in interdisciplinary discussions. And that means, as you know, conversations between subjects, between the different roles that you have with your colleagues at universities. I did a law degree here. I did a business law and organization studies degree. And I'm absolutely amazed that actually, when I think back on it, we talked about organizations around the world, but not once did we talk about the impact of an organization on its town, on the place, on its design. We did business law. Not once did we talk about business and cities. We didn't look at those connectors. And actually, we very rarely talked about equality and justice either. And that surprises me, because Lancaster University, I think, was a pretty modern university with a pretty modern agenda. And I think there's one role that universities have, and it has to be about creating a debate around placemaking. Not just conversations or part of syllabuses, but also about illustration through the estates that you manage, the designs that you create, and the kind of collaborations that you have. So, if you're looking for the business case, and we all are these days quite often, people need to know why should we do one more thing. I suspect you know this already, but I'm hoping you do this already. There's lots of research that's showing that actually, from one particularly from Projects for Public Space, who found that their work on universities, they did some research and found that actually when students make a choice about where they go, the place and the design of a campus or the university was equally as important as the subject or the alumni or the professors or lecturers. Now, they're your clients. They will come to you not only because of what you teach, but because of the space that you provide for them. And that's also within a building and outside of it. They want benches. They want green spaces. They want places inside the building where you can collaborate and have a discussion. Just have them sit next to an engineer and start talking to them. So, I'm going to kind of finish up. But I think if I'm talking to academics, I thought, well, what can I say that sounds clever? And I came across something and I liked that. And it's called the quadruple helix. I'm sure you know this anyway. And if you're thinking about all the connectors for placemaking, whether it's buildings, whether it's spaces, whether it's campuses, you need to think of four things. You need to think of the fact that you are part of an industry, whatever that might be, whether you're an architect, whether you're a designer, whether you're a policymaker, and many academics are. You're also part of a government decision. Now, in the UK, actually, there is a big place-making agenda. If any of you know about the Local Communities Act and the Local Act, actually, the government is rolling back the state. Communities are expected to start looking after buildings, green spaces. We are going to have a society that expects to be part of the management that you do, not only because it's private, but also because people see spaces as public more and more, and they will feel like part of your agenda. So the helix is industry, government, and academia, so you're in the right place, but also community. And I think sometimes universities and others, it's all of us sometimes, forget that actually, although we might be on a hill, when I was here actually, some of the local people used to call it Wuthering Heights. Is it still called Wuthering Heights, Lancaster? No? Okay. Right, that's good. That's good. You must be doing something right. You must be meeting people now. But at the time, that's what it was called. And the reason why is because actually, when I think about it, you know, we used to bus in to the town and back out again. didn't see what the connection was with local communities, with local businesses. It might have been happening behind the scenes, but we didn't see it. And it's crucial that that really happens now. As I said, we are all placemakers. So finally, there are some big opportunities for universities, and I really think it's about multidisciplinary work. And when I talk to young people and students and actually mature students and people thinking about going on to further education and lifelong learning, they're interested in the connections, the spaces in between, and the connect. I think it's important to think about triangulating. So a grand word, it just means clustering and putting together. If you have a university, you have a space, how does it connect to the local park? How does it connect to the unit of the town? How do you make sure those things are actually connecting in practice? And also, equally, a university should be actually providing the seeds of thought for sustainability, for sustainable development. I don't know if it was just me, it might have been. But it's a bit of a shame that I left after 3 years and I didn't know what sustainable development was until I did my master's in planning and environmental law. And kind of interestingly enough, maybe that helped because I was also on the UK Sustainable Development Commission. So I think maybe being an outsider helps a little bit to kind of question some of this. But I think ultimately, placemaking is not just about bricks and buildings. It's about creating a sense of place. You do need your business case, but most importantly, what you do is social and economic. It's not just about architecture and design and estate building, but it is about a far bigger agenda. And I'm hoping that you will be part of that, along with myself and others. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Maria. So next we have Julie Hirigoyen. She's CEO of the Green Building Council. The Green Building Council is a charity, industry-led network on a mission to improve the built environment.
That's right. No small task. I have a clicker, do I?
Do you?
Thank you. Well, good morning, everyone. I think it's still morning time. So let me just tell you a little bit about who we are and what we do. I'm going to bring the conversation, or I'm going to sort of expand the conversation out to kind of what the role of universities and colleges might be. And you'll probably tell me that I've got that wrong, but I'm going to issue a bit of a call to action. So just before I do that, who the UK Green Building Council is. We're a charity, as Graham mentioned. We've got a mission to radically improve the sustainability of the built environment, which is, as I say, quite ambitious. We've sort of broken that down into a vision, which is really about making sure that people and planet thrive through their interaction with the built environment. We have five main sort of associated kind of issues that we work on, namely climate change, health and well-being, resource efficiency, circular economy, nature and biodiversity, and sort of quality of life and long-term social value. We're a membership organisation. You'll recognise many of the names on this slide, probably. We've got 430 or so members, largely businesses, but not only. We've got something like 40 universities, or just over 40 universities now, and that's, I'll come back to that at the end. Our members are our lifeblood, so we're here really to sort of inspire, challenge, and encourage them to really push sustainability through their core activities as much as possible, and to sort of empower them to do that. I think it's just worth sort of highlighting some of the major challenges that we face. We've touched on some of them through what Graham and Maria said. We are at the stage where more than half the population now is living in cities. We're quite rapidly going to get to 75% of people living in cities. Cities use up only 3% of our landmass globally, but they use up 75% of our natural resources, and they emit 80% of our emissions. So this is a major, major focus for the SDGs, I would suggest, is cities. And obviously, we have got an agreement on climate change. I say obviously, there are some out there who are trying desperately to dismantle it. But we still have a global agreement. We have targets here in the UK to reduce our emissions 80% by 2050, which is really quite a steep trajectory. And buildings and the built environment emit something like 30 to 40% of our emissions, depending which geographical boundaries you're looking at. So there's a huge amount of work to do to decarbonize that built environment. And we basically need to take all buildings, new and existing, to zero carbon by 2050, if not sooner. So that's quite a big job in itself. We also have issues around air quality, and you can't have avoided some of that in the news. We've got something like 40,000 cases of premature deaths just in the UK annually from poor air quality. We've now got on the market children's masks for, you know, purifying the air that they breathe through the streets, but and parents are being told to zip up their buggies, and you know, it's actually quite scary. I used to think this was an issue from the olden days, but it really is quite frightening. And inequality, again, Graham highlighted some of these issues, and we've got something like 10% of our homes in the UK are fuel poor, and that's quite a statistic. And we've got a lot of work to do to get those people into kind of, you know, normal living standards, and obviously homelessness is on the rise and so on. So we've got a big job on our hands. I won't talk you through lots of the things that we do, but the two things that I think are worth highlighting, we do a lot more work with cities, specifically because of the point Maria made around the central government is sort of rolling back, the building regulations and so on are sort of going in the wrong direction on a national basis. But cities themselves are increasingly really keen to sort of push higher standards. And obviously there's a sort of devolution agenda and so on. So we've engaged already with three cities in quite some detail around what that looks like. And increasingly there's an appetite from cities to club together and to raise the bar beyond what national regs are requiring the development community to comply with. So some really encouraging stuff. We do lots of work on health and well-being, mainly because, there is a very strong correlation between green and sustainable building design and the quality of that environment for people. The typical business case for sustainability in buildings has been put around, has been made in the past around sort of, you know, it'll save you operational costs through energy and water savings and waste reductions and so on, all of which is true and is great stuff, obviously. But it typically isn't that material a cost for most businesses in particular, but also organisations. It's people that are the main cost. So something like 90% of a typical business's costs are related to staff, salaries, benefits, and so on, compared to, say, 1% on energy. So if you can tweak the environment that those people are working in to make them more productive, you've got a much better return on investment than you might have just on energy costs alone. As I say, some of this stuff around health and well-being is directly related to the kind of quality of the design, but also some of the environmental aspects of that. So we've done a lot of research in this space in offices, in retail properties, in homes, and now, interestingly, also in schools, we find very, very strong correlations between some of those two factors, the environmental design and the health and well-being aspects. Just to add to that, most employers don't have much brand loyalty amongst their staff, so this is also seen as kind of one of the ways in which to sort of make sure that people enjoy the spaces that they're working in and actually relate to the organisation a bit better. So you'll see the likes of Google are often quoted as kind of, you know, there's some of the more radical spaces. They are really pushing some of this agenda in order to sort of create even more loyalty amongst their staff and to attract and retain talent. Which is quite an interesting phenomenon. So just to give you some examples of some of the things out there that I'm talking about, I mean, natural ventilation is a really obvious one. There was a Harvard study done last year, well, actually, they concluded last year, I think it started the year before. They found that through much better sort of natural ventilation and air quality and low VOC type environments, you could improve cognitive function by up to 100%. That's really quite exciting for organisations in this room, I think, in terms of a learning environment and what you can do to improve that learning environment and the quality of that learning. Daylight is another obvious one. So people who work near windows and who have access to kind of natural daylight and so on are neuroscientists have worked out that they sleep on average, I love this one, an extra 46 minutes per night. I'd like to know how they work that out. But basically, they have, they've been exposed to much more light exposure, natural light exposure, and they therefore have better circadian rhythms and those sorts of things. And biodiversity, and there's a lot of work out there that sort of links people's well-being to kind of biophilia, so the plants and the views and the access to nature and these sorts of things, not least hospital visits that kind of get much reduced by as a result of people who've got views to nature and that sort of thing. So, of course, all of this evidence sort of builds the case for more sensitive design and environmental design in particular, because it benefits staff and students and visitors and so on. Building on that, I would put it out there that you have educational institutes have a number of different sort of wear a number of different hats, if I can put it like that, all of which really sort of offer an opportunity to drive the SDGs and a much more sort of sustainable agenda. So I'm going to sort of walk through some of those in brief, mainly your role as an educator, as a landowner, as an employer, as a key stakeholder in a town or city or place, and as an innovator, because all of these offer kind of slightly different opportunities. So let's just start with the educator role. I mean, there's an obvious point here, which is something like you'll probably correct me on this, but 2 or 2.5 million people in universities at any one time. And that's a huge chunk of the population coming through the sort of the built environment that is belonging to the university. And you can use that built environment or that those buildings in order to raise awareness about some of these issues. So almost like a live, living lab, we sometimes hear universities referring to it. So just to give you some examples, Manchester University, which isn't on the slide, but offers a day's worth of carbon literacy to anyone who works, lives, or studies in the city. So you can go along and have a day looking at carbon footprinting and the science of climate change and those sorts of things. The Crystal Building, which is on the slide in the middle there, which is in London, Siemens Building, and part of their Sustainable Cities exhibition space is kind of giving live feedback on how the building is performing on a number of different topics, like how much energy is being consumed, how much CO2 is being generated, how much water, and so on. So they're really raising awareness as people go through and use the building about how the building is performing. The Enterprise Centre, which is on the left there, designed by the University of East Anglia, an archetype and architect firm. They've got exposed thatched walls, as you can see there. That helps demonstrate the use of a kind of building material that's local, but also very sustainable. So they're sort of raising awareness by doing that. And then those strawberry trees at the end there, which are sort of mobile phone and other charging points, which are obviously solar panels, but as trees, quite an engaging way for people to actually understand where the energy is coming from and sort of raise awareness in an interactive kind of way. So there's lots of ways in which almost the buildings, I think, from an educational establishment perspective, could become almost like museums or experiences that kind of give people that sense of live learning and live awareness. Interestingly, quite a lot of businesses are cottoning onto this as well and are using some of those sustainability credentials of their buildings to raise the brand awareness and the sort of sustainability commitment of their staff. As landowners, obviously, universities have, you know, typically large mixed estates, quite a lot of buildings spread about, almost like mini villages or towns in their own right, and that offers the opportunity, because of the scale, to do some really interesting stuff. So to give you some examples, King's Cross in London has obviously undergone major regeneration. Argent, the developer there, have put in the largest district heating network in the country. They're generating heat from the engines that generate the electricity, and they're using that to sort of power, but also provide heating and hot water to lots of local residents, and they're doing that in a way that's really, really efficient. So at a scale, I mean, obviously universities, you know, campuses get built more, I imagine, piecemeal and not all in one go, but there are, at scale, there are really big solutions, integrated solutions that can work across such a large swathe of real estate. Also, I think things like battery storage will become really interesting in the next 5 years. So it's really worth kind of thinking about that in terms of electricity in particular. And then in terms of old buildings and retrofit, put an example up there of an old housing estate which has been refurbished in Portsmouth. They've managed to reduce the heating requirements by 90% by partnering up with Rockwool and improving what it was previously sort of poor living conditions into much better living conditions for the residents. But a lot of this can be done on commercial or kind of these types of buildings as well, where they're getting old. And the retrofit challenge that we have is absolutely enormous, particularly on homes. We need to refurbish or retrofit something like 1.4 homes a minute between now and 2050 if we're going to meet that 80% target. So we've got a major job on our hands, and our older buildings are a key part of that. There is some legislation that's come in, minimum energy efficiency standards from April next year, which mean that all privately leased or rented buildings can't be below a certain energy performance rating. F4G is no longer going to be acceptable. So if you're leasing buildings or if you're renting buildings out, you need to bear that in mind and do something about it. As an employer, clearly universities have a major role, so they're often the biggest employers in a locality, as I'm sure you'll know. University of Edinburgh, for example, third biggest employer in the city, 13,000 people. So there's a huge responsibility here to sort of make those people, to create working conditions that those people will thrive in and be productive in. So this comes back to the sort of health and well-being points I was making earlier. I mean, you'll see there's an example all the way on the right. We've refurbished our tiny little 150-meter-squared office space at UK-GBC in London, but we've put kind of the health and well-being and productivity of our staff right at the heart of that very tiny refurb. And it is possible to do stuff that is quite dramatic, that has really, really big effect on people's lives. Cundall is a firm of engineers. They were the first WELL-certified building. So WELL is a health and well-being certification standard for buildings that's come from the US, and it's kind of just starting to hit the market now in terms of market demand. They've refurbished their space. They've managed to sort of recoup the extra cost of doing that very quickly across a number of months, just by reduced absenteeism and reducing the number of people who are off sick and those sorts of things. And then last but by no means least, as a major stakeholder in the city, I think universities have a really sort of symbiotic relationship with the town or city or place where they're located. And just what we've done on this slide was highlight one of the good ways of sort of looking at that the symbiosis of that relationship is to look at the retention rates of students within the local area. And those universities or those cities that have the highest retention rate from students are also happen to be some of those that are the most sustainable within the Sustainable Cities Index. Now, we're not saying that is the reason, but it is quite interesting to note that they are obviously good places to be, and they are sustainable places to be. So there's clearly opportunities to influence the sort of the sustainability and the quality of the local area. And I won't say much more on that because Maria's touched on that a lot, but I think these issues like placemaking and biodiversity and green infrastructure, you know, you need to just sort of think about plugging into the wider place rather than just thinking about the estate that you're on. University is obviously also a key place to innovate, so better here than in the private sector, perhaps less risky. You've got kind of key research and you know, innovative ideas coming out from your academic disciplines that could be piloted on the estates, and there's some really exciting and interesting stuff coming out there. I mean, there's robots that are laying bricks 5 times faster than any bricklayer could, which is perhaps a good thing given the sort of skills shortages that we're facing. There are sort of buildings like the Edge in Amsterdam, which have sort of several hundred thousand sensors, which can work out recognize your car as you're driving in, not that you should be driving a car, but perhaps it's electric, and start making your coffee and kind of forget, you know, create the working environment that you want within the building and so on. So there's lots of ways in which to innovate, smart tech, circular economy, robotics and so on, and in universities seem like a prime place to do that. So I'm going to finish up because I'm conscious of time and Q&A, but there's lots of ways in which we would like to see universities and academic institutes more broadly champion this agenda through their built environment kind of roles and functions. We've got lots of things that, you know, you could get involved in. As I said, we're more and more keen to, we've got 45 or so universities, we're keen to kind of welcome any more that would like to within the fold. And I think there's lots of ways in which you can drive this agenda through wearing your various different hats. On which note, I'll stop and go to Q&A.
Thank you. Hopefully that's been informative, maybe provocative, in light of the poll at the start. We are very keen to hear from people here. As a kind of a prelude to that, I guess we'd like to ask you one more question. So we just return to the poll to ask you. There's a slight spin on this question, I guess. I'm interested in which, so obviously we've got, you can only choose one here, unfortunately. So I'm interested in the one that somehow kind of appeals most to your values, your kind of your professional or personal values. So tell us, which of these potential benefits, opportunities of universities and colleges taking a leadership position on the SDGs you think is most kind of interesting or you're most passionate about seeing happen? Okay, so that's relatively, well, it's quite interesting, I guess. So before we, just as people kind of compose their questions or thoughts, any immediate responses on that, Julie Maria?
Well, I think that's quite exciting because I think there's recognition of the sort of the scale of, this natural kind of opportunity to raise awareness and educate using the kind of the built environment and the fabric itself. So it's an obvious point, but it's not one that's yet, I think, been embraced fully within the built environment at large and these types of organisations. So if you did embrace that, I think there's a huge role that could be played.
I think actually for me it's just really great to see that we all got votes. I would have been disturbed if one of them had no votes whatsoever. No.
I'm not sure we had a none of the above option otherwise.
Okay, so they had to. Okay. I think what's really exciting as well is the innovative solutions. Yes. That we're looking at doing things differently, cleverly, and hopefully sustainable as well. And I'm also interested and pleased to see that 5.9% is one of the lowest, but still we're talking about community space and local economies because they're part of the placemaking agenda. Anyone else that's working on place needs to be looking at those two things.
So I'd like to just invite questions, comments, reflections, challenges from the floor. We're very keen to get a discussion going. What are people's thoughts or even examples from your own context in the light of what's been said? Yeah.
Thank you for a great presentation. Most of the people in this room are probably already sold. It's the directors of estates, directors of capital development projects, and people of that nature who probably need to be sold the ideas about health and well-being. And about some of these benefits that are really quite intangible. But we all know that they make sense. But it's about how do you really sell it to your CFO at your university?
I mean, it's the same question, as you might imagine, that we get asked by businesses time and time again. And we would encourage, certainly from UK-GBC perspective, encourage and support, and we're doing quite a lot of work on this, the evaluation of the benefits that can be incurred by doing this. And it tends to be, and we've put out quite a lot on business case of doing some of this stuff across the built environment. As I mentioned, health and well-being, that is one of the main reasons why we focus on that topic, because it is really quite powerful. It tends to sort of be, if you apply the people lens, it tends to start shifting perceptions. But there are businesses out there that are taking this really, really seriously in terms of measuring the value that they're generating from sustainability. And you can do that in lots of different ways. It just requires, obviously you're going to incur operational cost savings by implementing some of this stuff. You can survey and canvas people and ask them how important this was in their selection of, where to go and study, or you can, there's lots of ways in which you can do it, but it's important to get, in my view, quite sophisticated about how you do that, because it feeds it back and constantly sort of, enables you to raise the bar. I'm not a big, I think we need to do it from a moral perspective, to be honest, but I know that we won't convince everyone with that argument. So I think you just need to keep doing both, hearts and minds, and just provide compelling and, robust evidence. It can, it is out there. You can get it.
I mean, Living Space Projects has been doing quite a lot of work with developers most recently. And you're absolutely right, the economic argument is really crucial in this if we're to sell people. But there is a good one. If it's for private developers and social developers, actually, there is research to show that good placemaking actually does create an economic uplift, not only on the value of the land, but also you're more likely to get the next contract because you're only as good as the last one. If it's for universities, as I said before, your clients are the people that come and stay here and then say great things about it and then join the alumni and invest in what you do in the future. They do that not only because of the degrees they might get, but also because the experience they had in your buildings or the spaces as well. And I would probably say, I'll meet your CIFO and have a conversation and show the stats, but there are plenty these days. It does feel like a kind of heart agenda, but actually there's a lot of sophisticated economics behind why this makes sense, as well as why it's just the right thing to do.
And just to tack on, those of you who don't know, so you might ask what the government's doing about all this. The government has just released what they call a national approach to the SDGs, overseas but also at home, that goes through every goal and talks overseas and at home, some examples of what they're doing. I think that's sort of interesting. Like, the significant thing that's going to come is they're refreshing all of the single departmental plans across Whitehall to somehow, well, we're not quite sure how far this is going to go, align them to the SDGs. So obviously what the DfE or similar kinds of bodies or the EFRA says about how they think their policies map onto the SDGs was going to kind of, well, we hope that kind of, first off, it kind of creates a point that you can see and you can kind of push against, but also it creates a context in which that might help make the business case for aligning with the SDGs. If this becomes part of the TIF or the government encourages or sustainability reporting or SDG reporting from universities or green procurement comes to universities or gets more mainstream, then there are obvious kinds of ways in which this filters through.
It's certainly local authorities are doing exactly that. I had a conversation with a group of people at the GLA. Fairly senior, and they were talking about which SDGs that they look at and focus on. So if you're working with local authorities, which you will be, that is something that's going to be part of your agenda.
Yes, that's it, I think. Did you want, I saw your hand go up next, is that?
I just have one.
Yes, so I was really interested in looking at your list about student retention, and I think, was it showing that London was at the top? And I thought that was quite interesting because, so I work on Oxford Street with obviously the worst NO2 levels possibly in the world, which is great, but one of the things that I feel about London is that obviously there's lots of amazing placemaking, but in terms of the wellness of our buildings, there's probably a lot that is pretty awful. And it's quite interesting to think about the fact that there are some things that are obviously going right enough to retain the students, and I wondered if you could say what those were so I can think a little bit about how, although we're really challenged in terms of things like air pollution, we could perhaps expand some of the things that are going all right.
Yeah, I mean, I think London skews it a little bit. I don't, you know, only because there's a huge job market. So there'll clearly be reasons that relate to job opportunities why people stay in particular places, I would imagine, which isn't necessarily canvassed in the same survey. But so, you know, I think, you know, they tend to be the larger conurbations if you look down the list where the retention levels are high. But I think there is that interesting correlation between the sort of almost the commitment to improving the sustainability of the built environment and that kind of that piece around how people are willing to stay. And I think it relates to the previous question, actually, because, you know, there is no doubt that, and there are lots of studies that are proving this, by the way, at the moment, but you guys are in a good position to actually do your own. There's no doubt that younger generations have this much, much higher up their agenda, that the environmental and particularly the social issues are really, really crucial. They're less driven by, if you ask, you know, from recruitment purposes and so on, by salary and by benefits and by job for life and those sorts of things, they're much more driven by a company's kind of commitment to some of these social, ethical, environmental issues. And therefore, their commitment to a place, in my view, would probably also be about that. So when Maria, you were telling us to close our eyes and think about a place, I think for me some of those issues were right in my heart, sort of, you know, what I can touch and feel about how dirty is it or how clean is it and those sorts of things. I don't know.
Well, I think London is an interesting case because I also live in London and I know what you mean about the air pollution, but I think it's a kind of different space. It almost deserves a different page on this whole placemaking agenda. I think people go to universities in London because obviously some of the issues that Julie mentioned, great buildings, sustainable, green, leading in it. but they also go because of the wider issue as well, the wider space. It's a great city. You can do things. It has brilliant parks. It is incredibly diverse. Everything you want is there. It's bloody expensive, but some people are willing to put up with that. So it's about the university, but it's also about what surrounds it. And London is an exciting place, as is Lancaster.
Just remember, other universities and cities are available.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. I was really interested in whether or not there is good guidance out there, effectively to CEOs of institutions, when they've made the decision about capital investment, but before they've recruited the developers and everything else about placemaking, because it's a phrase that is now being used absolutely everywhere. But when you start to try and interrogate the phrase for what are the key ingredients and the key processes that need to be in place in the context of universities or colleges being placemakers, it's much harder to find something you can put in front of key people to say, take into account these issues because you will get a better outcome. You won't get just a building, but you'll get a contribution to the fabric of a community.
Need your book?
Yeah, well, buy my book, The Placemaking Factor. Actually, I mean, you're right, there's not enough out there, and the problem is with placemaking, anyone can hijack it for various things, because it's such a lovely sounding thing, isn't it? And I was in New York 2 years ago doing some research for the book, and basically a lot of people are saying, this is a developer's agenda, this is about making a space look pretty, or a campus look pretty, just to get people in. But I think actually placemaking is a process, as you've just suggested. It's more than that. It's about who gets involved in design, who gets involved in the longevity of a building, the space, how it's used, and the benefits that it will bring. There's a recent report, and probably most of you have seen it, it's by Savills, which is called Valuing Placemaking. So if you have colleagues who are really looking for the pound sign and want to know what it means there, I think that's really good. Report. It is aimed more at private housing development, but I think it also makes sense for universities and estate managers as well. And also, there's some good work that's been done by the Urban Lab at King's College, I think. Also, the Bartlett School as well. And if you want to go across the pond, also Projects for Public Space have done some really good work on universities. And we're doing a little bit as well. But it is out there, but it's not easy to get. I'm hoping that the university you all work with will bring some of that research to bear.
So I'm conscious we're running short of time, so we started late. We're going to finish ever so slightly late. There's two more people who want to ask questions. Can I ask you both to be brief, and we'll take them both together, and then we'll just invite final responses.
My question is based on the experience of a member of staff, actually. When you come to building, I'm not a builder, I'm a lecturer. A few years ago, my university went through some kind of a massive transformation, and they built some beautiful buildings that are award-winning. But actually, when it comes to like a hierarchy of where, you know, kind of the needs of a beautiful place is, you know, kind of, what do people consider? Is it beauty, the greenness, the plugs, and then members of staff? Because what happened to members of staff that they were all pushed in these big communal offices? And I'm not a great fan of communal offices. And we did have health and well-being in one of the sessions, and one of the colleagues mentioned that, what about people? We need nice people. So how do we change cultures to fit in and actually make better people? Because at the end of the day, these buildings are for people. Is it possible that, I don't know, is it a chicken and egg? We make better buildings and then we have better people, or vice versa?
Yes, hello, my question is a much more general one. I would just like to know your few thoughts on the challenges to placemaking of a growing global population.
So any final thoughts on those questions?
I mean, just taking the last question first, just because it's a really live issue, and Maria will have more to say on it than I, but the density issue is a really big one. So obviously, we don't yet, as far as I know, from a healthy neighbourhood and health and well-being of people in very, very tightly dense, packed spaces, gets stressed. You know, we're stressing that kind of relationship. It makes for the fact that we, it builds the case for us to build more outside green spaces, more, you know, green roofs, balconies, you know, better accessibility and connectivity within the space, more reflective spaces. There's all sorts of, you know, there's quite a lot of sort of research that's going on, as you would expect, in that area live at the moment. Some of the schemes that are going up in London are unparalleled in terms of the density levels that they're planning, and it's sort of back to, it's like Hong Kong sort of, you know, equivalent. So I think we're about to stress test quite a lot of that. On the first question, I thought it was a brilliant question. How do you improve the people, not the places? I think the place can improve the people and certainly the way in which they interact with one another. I mean, we've, just talking from our tiny little space, we've put lots of much more diverse places that people can interact, and we're finding people stand up and have meetings, you know, work together a lot more rather than sitting at a desk and doing stuff on their own. So I think there's certainly the space can enhance collegiate collaboration. Whether it can change people's personalities, I'm not sure.
Communal space. I think it depends on the individual. I think a really well-designed space actually allows for private space.
Yeah.
So those that don't do that actually can go somewhere else and sit in the cubicle if that's what you require. I think that's the good space, is when actually you think about human need, and not everyone wants to be sat around a table having a conversation on a green sofa. They want to be at a desk, boxed off, and I think that's absolutely fine, and good design will do that. As far as the challenges, yes, massive. And as you said, actually we're all part at the moment of a massive big urban innovation hub, just by living in cities, on going through them and working around them. We're not sure yet what it's going to look like. I think we're going to have to deal with density. We're going to have to think about cities being different to the way they are now. We're going to have to better design homes and houses. At the moment, they are way too small. And as Julie said, we need to get better green spaces and open spaces. So if we can't provide them in a space where someone lives, then you need to provide them outside of that. And the last thing, which is political but also state management, is that we mustn't lose public spaces. Mm-hmm. They're really crucial.
Thank you very much. So thank you to you all for coming. Thanks for staying even though we ran over so slightly. Thanks for your participation. Thanks to both Julie and Maria. Enjoy your lunch, enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you.
Yep.